Nice and loud.
Well, thank you everyone for coming tonight. And I'm so happy to be, it's my honor to be here tonight. Muchas gracias a todos por estar aquí esta noche. Los que gusten sentarse, hay mesa de este lado. Hay otra mesa creo que a la entrada. Por favor, si gustan pasar, me encantaría que se sientan cómodos porque vamos a tardar un ratito aquí. Y si todos están listos, pues podemos comenzar, ¿verdad? Bueno, mi nombre es Esperanza Galindo. Yo soy, ahora sí que, locutora. Acabo de sacar mi libro. No estoy aquí para promocionarme, pero estoy aquí para ayudar a Néstor Enrique Valencia. Y thank you everyone for being here. My name is Esperanza Galindo. I just finished my book. I'm a writer. I do some things that I cannot finish if I, you know, if I talk too much. But you know, I'm very happy to be here supporting Néstor Enrique Valencia. And you know, thank you also to Jorge Gaston to be here. It's my honor, you know, they're both here, you know, helping each other for the best of Bell. So,
and the county.
And the county,
yes,
and the county. So we have a really good background. Estoy muy orgullosa de estar aquí esta noche. Ahora sí que representando, ¿verdad? Estamos representando a Bell y al condado. Estoy muy orgullosa de que Mr. Gastón está aquí, ¿verdad? Él tiene una reputación ya de muchos años y sigue todavía aún luchando, ¿verdad? Contra la corrupción y todo lo demás que está pasando en nuestro país. Yo pienso que todos esta noche estamos aquí por una misma razón, ¿verdad? Tener un mejor país. So, we all here, you know, to enjoy it, and we all want the best for our country. And it's my honor to let you to talk now, Ernest. Néstor, oh my God. Enrique Valencia Guerrero.
Thank you so much. Let me say welcome to the City of Bell. As your local council member and former mayor, I very honored to have you here at this fine restaurant. It's brand new. We're always trying to help the local economy. I also want to give a very special welcome and a welcome back home to Jorge Gascon, who's running for our county district attorney's office, and please give him a round of applause. He's going to do a great, great work for us. And it's gonna, so don't worry, we just met, you know, so I don't expect anybody to get my name correct. Yes, my name is Néstor Enrique. Most people that know me call me Ricky, or Enrique or Quique, you know? But I want to welcome you to Ramon, Blanca, thanks for being here. I just want to say a few words first about the City of Bell quickly, and then I want to move on to tell you about Jorge or George. The City of Bell has seen better days in terms of our local government officials. 10 years ago, there was a big scandal, and it was because of the Bell Resident Club, the pin that I wear today, that engaged our local government and invited others to be civically minded, to engage. It wasn't so much to take out corruption, it was so much for civic participation, community pride, volunteerism, and least but not all, leadership. We want to develop leaders. Today, I'm running for re-election for a third term, and I'm running with my friend Marco Oliva and another gentleman, Jimmy Jamal Murad, who can't be with us today. And me and Marcos, we don't see eye to eye in all aspects, but we do know what good government is. We do know about transparency. También bailo bien. We do know about good government. We know about transparency. We know that we have to stay on top of local government because government has a very odd, strange habit of getting into its old habits. And that's why we're running for re-election, and that's why he's running, because we want not to slip into the old days. We have some great opportunities in our downtown that hasn't happened. We have some great opportunities with getting good staff. We have some great opportunities with the community. And all it is the quality of life. We bring it down to every local government, every state, even our nation should be seeking for its residents, for its citizens, the quality of life. That's what we're aiming for here in Bell. We're not trying to take corruption away when there is. We're not trying to tell people they're bad actors when there are. We're trying to remind them that we want and we would represent the quality of life for our children, our senior citizens. So that being said, I want to let you know too that this evening won't be possible if it wasn't for the Bell Resident Club, which I mentioned earlier that we founded back in 06 and 07. I'm gonna give him a little shout out because he's been there with me since day one, Mr. Jason Vega, right here. More recently, Nora Sainz, who is our lead planning commissioner here in the city of Bell. Welcome, Nora. There's some very prominent community leaders here. I'm gonna point a couple out, but I know everybody's important this evening. I wanna welcome Javier and Graciela Reyes. They're the chief executive officer for our local Los Angeles High School here in the city of Bell, a public charter school. Thank you for your support. Going back to the Bell Resident Club, regresando aquí al Club de Residentes de Bell, que empezamos todo el desenlace de la corrupción aquí en Bell. Because we thought out to put this organization and this community grassroots organization, I started looking for people that were fighting corruption. Empecé a buscar a la gente, a las personas en gobiernos locales que luchaban por la integridad y la honestidad y la confianza del gobierno público. We were fighting really for public trust, to bring back public trust. And that's how I found George Gascon. I found him as the district attorney for San Francisco, the county, right? Yeah. The county of San Francisco. And he didn't go up there to end corruption. He didn't go up there to keep people, local officials in jail. He didn't do that. I am a football official. When a young person in sports does something egregiously wrong, like fighting, breaking the rules, we don't disqualify them. They disqualify themselves. Likewise, when bad officials act up, they did it to themselves. But it holds to us in good government and public trust that we have to call them out on it. We cannot shy away from it, even if our jobs are on the line, even if they put you there. We have this going on, apparently, on the national politics. But I worry about our local government. And that's why I noticed George. And I was trying to write to him, I was trying to call him, you know, I finally got to someone to get a message over to him. Because I wanted to award him with a huge plaque, which something that commended him for his courage, his genuine courage to go after bad apples in government. And he did. And he succeeded. And I think, and I believe, and I trust that he will do the same wherever he comes. He has come back to LA to do an awesome public service job. He's come back to LA County to be the best district attorney we've ever had, probably in my lifetime. I got here in 1975. I know that George is gonna do a fine work. I don't have those big plaques for him. Those days are long gone that I could put something out. But I wanna humbly, in a community way, I wanna give him this pin that we've given to several people in public service, including our teachers. The Bell Rustin Club every year we give the Teacher of the Year Award to remind our teachers about their public service. So tonight we're gonna let George have the words on his campaign, but tonight I also want to give him this pin and these cards to remind him that public service, it's a privilege, to remind us of what the Bell Resin Club did for us, is to remind him of the principles of public service that I know he will uphold. George, please accept this. Please, it's just a small token. We'll do better, you know. Thank you, and welcome back to the neighborhood.
Thank you.
Adelante.
So you're not Nestor anymore, you're Kiki. First of all, and you know, I don't know if you want to sit here. I think you have you in my back. No, because I'd like to. First of all, thank you. Thank you all. And thank you, Kiki, for putting this together. You know, I know that we all have really busy work, and you know, the end of the day and the weekday is tough. Listen to people that are running for public office and people that are public office. What Kiki said, it really resonates with me because, you know, a significant part of my professional career, I wound up walking into places where I was not expecting to see corruption and then getting embroiled in having to fight corruption and what I believe, quite frankly, sometimes to be the forces of evil. And I don't want to you know, overstate this, but you know, I spent most of my career here in the LAPD, going from the rank of a police officer to assistant chief. But I grew up right down the street here. I grew up in Callahay, came from a very, you know, working class family. My family, the first place that we lived in Callahay, for those of you that know Callahay, we were in Elizabeth, near Atlantic. We lived in a two-bedroom apartment. And I got to sleep on the couch in the front. That was the order of things. And you know, for us, quite frankly, that was luxury given where we came from in Cuba. But when I became a police officer, I was really proud that I was going to work in communities much like the one that I grew up and make a difference. And you know, throughout my career, I found myself fighting corrupt policing inside the LAPD. And then I wound up, after years, being recruited to be a chief of police in Mesa, Arizona, and finding out that I was embroiled in a big fight before I got there with a sheriff, a guy named Joe Arpaio. How many of you remember Joe Arpaio? Okay, for those of you that don't know, I'm going to get walk you through. Do I need to go on Spanish or English?
English is good, we'll subtitle it.
Okay, so your bio was a sheriff in Maricopa County, one of the largest counties in the country, and he became a national hero to the anti-immigrant community. He would go around doing what we got to call their immigration raids, and if you were brown and you were driving, you were going to get stopped. And it got so bad that because the county sheriff oversees the entire county, even though he was not policing our city, and we have a city of about 500,000 people, he would come in, his people come into our city often, and they would create terror, and I mean terror. I had community members in the Latino community coming to me and saying, we're afraid to take our kids to school because we may get stopped for a minor traffic violation or one that was fabricated, and you know, maybe the husband will end up getting deported, even though the kids were born in Arizona, or the wife was born in Arizona, or vice versa. And it got so bad that we had several times where U.S. citizens, people that were born in either Mesa or Phoenix, were deported to Mexico. And one of the more egregious cases, a young man that had Down syndrome, he was about 18 years old, he was deported and dropped off in Mexico, and he spent about 2 weeks homeless walking around the streets. He did not speak Spanish, and he could figure out what to do in order how to get to back to the U.S., and his family reported him missing because they had no clue that this young man had been deported. That occurred in the United States, in the state of Arizona, in the county of Maricopa County, only about 10 years ago. And some of that, by the way, is starting to occur nationally now. But when I saw that, I square off, I took on a file, I went to the Justice Department, made a complaint that eventually led to his prosecution, that then the current president pardoned him after he was convicted. I went to Congress to provide sworn testimony, and by the time I finished providing sworn testimony in Congress, I was called and said, you're bringing too much heat to the city, you need to go. And that's when Gavin Newsom, who was then the mayor of San Francisco, recruited me to be the chief of police there. And then later on I became the district attorney, and I was the district attorney for two terms, a little over 8 years. Actually, I was initially appointed and then running successfully around twice. And then I found myself, again, stumbling into public corruption and taking on, you know, people in government that were stealing from the public, that were breaking the public trust. And then, you know, that included not only political elected officials, but it included police officers as well. So to the point that Nestor is bringing, I am definitely someone that would be looking at public corruption with a very keen eye, because I think that those of us that elect, whether work for government or become an elected official, it's an honor, but it's also a responsibility that we're there not for ourselves, we're there for public service. And when people forget that, and they become a self-contractor for self-benefit at the expense of the public and the taxpayers, then there needs to be consequences. But more importantly, the reason why I came back home and decided to run, that was not the original plan. The original plan, frankly, just simply, I'm coming back home, my family's here, my mother is doing very poorly, and I don't have any siblings, and my wife and I were coming back and forth very often. And really, we're coming back, I was gonna go into practice, practice law privately. And a lot of people here in the county and other parts of the state say you need to run against the current DA. And the more that we look at what was going on in the county, the abuses that have been going on, you know, looking the other way when you have really powerful people committing pretty horrendous crimes, but on the other hand, where poor people are doing sometimes things that everybody else does, they happen to be black or they happen to be brown, the consequences generally are very punitive. And seeing that that's not necessarily making the county any safer, you know, violent crime has gone up by about 30% under the current administration. So we see more incarceration, especially mentally ill people. We have a jail now that, according to multiple studies, anywhere between a third and a half of the jail population every day in the largest jail in the country are mentally ill. And mentally ill people do not do well in custody. They need treatment. We have criminalized sometimes the people that are drug addicted and mentally ill. We great expense to all of us, not only in terms of a dollar expense, because the money that we're spending in our jail system and our criminal justice system has completely outstripped money for other services like social services, schools, parks, even fixing the potholes on the street in many communities. But we're doing it in a way that is breaking down families and communities and not really having any end in sight, because when people are mentally ill, people have substance abuse, going in and out of jail isn't fixing, right? We can't cure cancer with a hammer. We cannot cure mental health by putting people into concrete boxes. It just doesn't fix the problem. So I'm very focused in coming in and leading a different approach to community safety that actually entertains science, that works on data, that brings what we know and tries to research and understand what we don't know, but above all, that is going to be protective of all of our communities, that is going to provide quality of enforcement, that is going to be respectful, that money should not be the currency of whether you get good services or not. The other part that I'm very committed to doing, because obviously I grew up down the street, is I know that the county of LA tends to be very LA city centered at the expense of the other cities around. We know that there are 88 cities, 140 unincorporated areas in the county, but when you look at most of the services, the further you go out to the outskirts of the county, the less likely you are to get services. I was in Pomona the other day talking to a group very much like you, and I had women that work at a nonprofit that were telling me that when the young girls get arrested for low-level offenses, if they're put in diversion, they have to go all the way to Norwalk for treatment, or they have to pay for the treatment. Guess what? If you live in Pomona and you don't even have a car, how do you get to Norwalk, right? And if you cannot pay for the treatment, then you get violated. But if you don't have money, you don't have a job, how do you pay for the treatment, right? So it's all this lack of connection that we have countywide. And one of the things that I want to make sure is that if I get elected, is that we're going to be representing every part of the county.
When you get it.
Yeah, well, thank you. So with that, I want to stop talking because I can talk to you guys until you fall asleep. And just want to open up for any questions that you may have. No question is...
How are you supposed to
try to
savage
boarding,
right?
I'm sorry?
Savage
boarding. Yeah, en español también. Perdone que seguía hablando en inglés, pero quiero que pueda usar español o inglés. Hablo mejor español que inglés. Any questions? ¿Alguna pregunta?
¿Qué tal? ¿De dónde viene tu familia?
Claro, claro, claro.
Para que te conozcan un poquito, para los que no te conocen.
Mi familia emigró aquí en los años 60 de Cuba. Yo me crié aquí en Caracas. Nos criamos en una situación muy modesta. Mi mamá y papá trabajaban en una fábrica. Vivimos en un apartamento, un solo cuarto. Yo le digo a la gente, yo dormía en el sofá, en la sala, ya, ¿verdad? Y aquí viví hasta que ya me fui para el ejército después. Todavía cuando regresé al ejército, mi familia siguió viviendo en Caracas por muchos años, aunque después se movieron para Baldwin Park. Yo viví en Southgate por un tiempo, después ya eventualmente vivimos en Moscovino. Pero me crié aquí, salí de aquí a la Armada, y regresé, fui a la universidad aquí en Long Beach, después fui al departamento de policía de Los Ángeles, y ahí empecé desde patrullero hasta ser el segundo jefe. De ahí fui jefe de policía en Arizona, donde tuve una batalla muy grande con el alguacil de Arizona, que era un tremendo antiinmigrante. De ahí fui a San Francisco, donde fui jefe de policía, y después fui fiscal del condado de San Francisco por 8 años. Y hace un año decidí regresar a mi familia, y cuando regresamos, mucha gente empezaron a pedirme que considerara correr para fiscal aquí, y decidí hacerlo porque creo que puedo traer una manera de mejor justicia, más igualdad, de una forma que sea nuestro trabajo y de mejorar la seguridad pública.
Years past, it seemed the public corruption unit of the DA's office seemed to be a little more active, and although they may have had a tenure, I think, when citizens from Bell and other places brought issues to them, etc., it did seem that they were more active, whether it be here, Vernon, or other cities in the southeast. How will you possibly change having your ear open or having a representative open to hear from people who might bring to you thoughts on public corruption that might be happening in their cities in the Southeast?
Yeah, well, I mean, first of all, well, it's true, they have been a little more active, but still, if you look at it from a 30,000 feet level above the ground, what you see is being very selective enforcement, right? There are some parts of the county where there's significant corruption that continues to go unattended. So it's a mixed bag, right? Not to say that maybe some of the people who are prosecuted shouldn't have, but the question is, the selectivity of it is questionable, especially when you look at other factors. So the first thing that I want to do is, first of all, I want to make sure that we have a robust operation, but secondly, that we're equitable and fair about the way we look at public corruption. I think it's important to look across the board. I think sometimes the corruption actually is in large corporations that are also participating in some of the corruption, right? And you often see very light touch with some of the stuff. I mean, you look at what happened in Rolling County with Southern California Gas, the explosions, and many homes that were lost. There was a lot of evidence of, cross corruption there. And yet, when they prosecuted the corporation at a very low level, settled for a very low dollar amount, not get restitution for the hundreds of people that lost their homes. But yeah, you have somebody that walks into a small business, maybe, and is hungry and steals some food, and they get arrested, they do 4 or 3 months in jail, and they have to pay restitution. So the balance of that is very problematic. So to answer your question, yeah, I plan to have a very robust look, but also one that tries to strike a balance in the work. I don't think corruption is limited to the small cities in the Southeast. Mm-hmm. Yes.
We're in education. One of the things that we worry about is chronic absenteeism. And I understand for larger school districts, they have a relationship with the superintendent's office through councils called SARPs. This is for LAUSD, I know that exists. They have a great relationship because it's a large institution. We run charter schools, we're small. We don't have the opportunity to have those kinds of councils that deal with chronic absenteeism and the roots of that, of the chronic absenteeism. How does the district attorney, how would you address those issues for the smaller schools and maybe private schools as well?
Yeah, well, I think we address it the same way. Obviously, there are different scales. But, if we're going to get into that space, then we have to address people equally. When I was in San Francisco, of course, it's a much smaller district. It's, I think, 80,000 now. But we actually initially took money from our general fund to pay for attendance workers. And basically, we set up partnerships with the school district, so when kids were not showing up for school, we would call it home. We actually send, we work with nonprofits and go pick up the school kids and take them to school. Often work with parents that were drug addicted, that had substance abuse problems, or that were unemployed. So you have to take each case on their own. We work very aggressively with creating mentoring and tutoring programs for the kids that were risk, especially in the transition from elementary to middle school, because that seems to be, according to the experts, if you don't make that transition from the 6th into the 7th, depending on where your middle school lies in your district, that seems to be a place that where kids really start falling off the track. And a lot of times the kids become disengaged from the school community. So looking for ways to get the kids to be reintegrated or integrated perhaps in school community that were never part of it. Often because there may be language problems, there may be all kinds of things going on at home, domestic violence and many other problems. So it's really trying to understand each family and trying to provide the right level of intervention that is going to work. But it requires that everybody works together, right? The VA is not going to fix the truancy problem in any one school or school district. We can play a role, and the role can be one of intervening with the right tools at the right time. But there there is no reason why we put most of our resources in one part of the educational system in Arellano. So obviously there's a scale issue, right? So if LA USC is 90% of the problem, they should get 90% of the resources, but they still then 10% of the resources to one or the other. And if we have to build out resources, then how do we work together? How do we bring other partners to the table as well? Right, truancy generally is complicated and it's very fact sensitive to each family, right? We often saw people where the parents were mentally ill, or the parents had substance abuse problem. One set of circumstances, another set of circumstances, I give you my example. Both of my parents went to work really early. My parents had two jobs each because they could not pay the bills, and they were, you know, hardworking people. They left in the morning around 6:45. You know, I was supposed to be in school by 8:00 in the morning. Sometimes I went to school, sometimes I didn't. They didn't get back home until 6:00. Guess what? By 6:00, I was already headed back home, where eventually I had a part-time job. I got to do my mother's signature very well back in those days. The way you got excused was that you took a note. I was the sickest kid on the 11th grade. I think I had about 40-some days that I was sick on the 11th grade. You know, so again, it's really understanding, right? My parents were not drug addicted, they were not mentally ill, but my parents were monolingual Spanish speakers. They came from a, you know, even though we grew up in Havana, we grew up in a small area of the city where everybody knew each other. If I was running around the street in the middle of school day, one of my neighbors would grab me on the ear and call her and take me to school. Well, here that didn't happen, right? My neighbors didn't even know who the hell I was, right? So again, it's adapting to the situations, and you have to do it community by community.
The candidate has a question.
Hey.
For the other candidate. También tengo una pregunta para el candidato, and I will preface it. Ya tengo 8 años como elegido. I have 8 years of elected work here in the city of Bell, and city of Bell being a small community, we still have a police department, and other cities too. And you know, police departments obviously help reduce crime in our local communities. But last year, there was a legislation that pretty much put sunlight, shed some transparency on police records.
Yeah.
How is your office going to work with that? Because I understand it's rather controversial, including here in the city of Bell, some of the police officers and higher up are not too thrilled about that.
Yeah. Well, look, I mean, California has some of the most protective laws around police personnel files, right? I work in Arizona. As a chief of police in Arizona, everything is fair game, right? You can do public records requests on any public servant, including police, and the world did not fall apart, right? But what it does do is it brings light when you have police officers that are engaged in corrupt practices like excessive use of force, well, they're cheating in their overtime, or you know, which is basically stealing money from all of us. And the only way that you cure that is by making it public. You don't cure it by hiding it. So I understand that a lot of people in policing here, including good people, are very apprehensive about this because they grew up in this cloak of privacy and secrecy. But the reality is, look, as a lawyer, if I get disciplined by the state bar, all you have to do is Google my name on the State Bar website. It will tell you right now if I have a discipline history and what that is for. If you're a medical doctor, right? But yeah, if you're a police officer, you Google what's happening in police, whatever you want to call it, and you get a wall, right? Now, when you look at your police department, and I'm going to take a guess, that your budget, probably police and fire, at least somewhere about 50%, of your budget,
yes.
Maybe more?
Yes.
He's right. Being conservative.
Well,
I'm
going to
get in more trouble, but yes.
I'm being nice, right?
Yeah.
Okay, so you're paying a lot of money. You have a huge pension liability that keeps growing every year. And every time that you talk about growing your police department by 10%, you know, you're thinking about this may be popular for you to get elected today, but you know, what you're doing is you're creating a nightmare for the next council people 30 years from now when that pension liability rolls in and you don't have money to pay, right? We have a lot of cities in the state that could very well go bankrupt just by paying public service employee pensions, but mostly public safety pensions, right? So if you're paying that much, I think you deserve to get the best, right? I think that entails that you should know if you have a police officer that has lied in court, because you have to question whether that should be a police officer. I'll tell you one of the things that the current DA won't do, I did in San Francisco, and I will do, and this is the reason why police unions are after me, by the way.
Yes, we know.
We will bring, yeah.
They're after me, too.
they put $2 million against me, okay? We created a no-call list. What is a no-call list? Any lawyers in the room? Okay, no lawyers. Let me tell you what a no-call list is. A no-call list is if you have a police officer that has a history of lying or committing what is called a moral turpitude crime, we would not call him to be a witness in the stand. Because how can you have somebody that has a history of lying raise their right hand in front of 12 people and say, I'm going to tell you the truth, and then we're going to believe them, we may send somebody to prison for 5, 10, 15, 20 years based on the word of someone that has already been proven to be a liar? To me, that's an inherent conflict. And the current DA has refused to create a no-call list. I will create a no-call list. I can tell you I've had deputy DAs today, well, not today, but here, in the last few days, they called me. He is in the Alhambra branch of the DA's office. He said, I got a report from a Monterey police officer that I know that this officer, first of all, has a history of lying, number one, and number two, I'm reading this report, and it reads like Alice in Wonderland. Meaning, you know, the trade basically saying this is a report that is probably full of lies. And you have a young man that is facing the potential of going to prison for 10 years based on the testimony of a liar, on the report that you have a young prosecutor saying this is not happening. So he refuses to file the case. The chief of police calls the district attorney the following day. The next day, he gets a call from the executive office of the DA's office that you will file the case. Now think about the level of corruption involved in this. Now this may be abstract to some of us, but guess what? If it was your kid, if it was your brother, or your sister, or if it was you, you would not think this is an abstract concept. Right? I was just talking at a law firm today where they're defending someone that they have proven that the person is factually innocent and is still having to fight the case, even after they have shown that the person is factually innocent. You know, very recently, a few weeks, 4 or 5 weeks ago, there was a case of Mr. Martinez. How many of you know the case of Mr. Martinez? Yeah, see, it's a problem. And I'm telling you this because, you know, in order to be accountable, we also have to take a little time to learn about these things. Mr. Martinez was prosecuted in 2007, 2008. For robbery and assault and a few other things. And he went to prison. In 2012, the investigators in the case, the police investigators, went to the district attorney, not the district attorney's office, the district attorney, said, we have come to the conclusion this man's innocent. It took 7 years to release him. This is a man that when he went to prison, these kids were little ones. He has got getting out of prison later on, about 12 years later, they're teenagers. He was innocent. The DA knew that he was innocent in 2012. She just released him right before a primary election. And then they go and they cry about her and they hug. And the man is so nice, because I tell you, he's a lot nicer than I was, because I would tell her to go F herself. And he actually has forgiven her. I don't know how many of you have been inside a prison. I'm not going to ask you to raise your hand, but I have been many times inside prisons. I have worked with people inside the institution and people that come out. And I can tell you that doing 10 or 12 years in an American prison It's not pleasant. In fact, doing 1 year in an American prison is not pleasant. Doing 1 day, it will change you for the rest of your life. And here we have an innocent person that's spending additional 8 years in prison after the people that investigated him, which is very unusual. I think in my entire life I have enough fingers in my hand to count the times that a cop has come to me and said, we got the wrong guy, boss. And for this to happen, and still take another 8 years for the person to get released.
I want to do a follow-up, George, for him. On a positive note, I've been at this public service now 8 years. One of the things I knew coming into bail, one of the things I know as a healthcare administrator, hospitals, medical groups, schools, corporations, we have always an organizational culture. Police departments, fire departments, schools have these organizational cultures that sometimes go awry. I know I've had to deal a lot. I've had to always work to try to, as an administrator, as a manager, director, I'm always, I like to have my finger on the pulse on that culture. Some people allege that the police culture is what's wrong. What will your office, on a positive note, what can we do as electives, as residents, if we don't have a police commission, or if we do, what can we do as residents? Regular citizens, what can we do to change that culture?
Well, look, let's begin by saying that policing is hard work. It's not easy. And the majority of the women and men in uniform go into work every day and try very hard to do the right things. So I don't want anybody to walk away thinking that I think that police is inherently evil. It's not. The problem is that sometimes a few people that are doing things wrong have such an impact on the rest of us, because police are the only people in a society like ours, in a democracy, that are given the authority to take our freedom away. They're given the authority to take our life in some situations, just by the ability to use that force. So they have to be held to a much higher standard, right? And part of that standard goes to how do we make sure that the cultures within police departments are one of transparency, one of fairness, and one of honesty, right? As the district attorney is the guard dog, if you will. You're the one that guards the gates of the entire system. And in order to do that, you have to be willing sometimes to do unpopular things, right? And it's very unpopular for a district attorney to go after a police department or to go after some police officer, because most of the day they're working together. But if you don't do that, no one else will. That's what you get constitutionally. The DA is the chief law enforcement officer of the county under the Constitution of the State of California. It's not the chief of police. It's not the sheriff. It's the district attorney. And the reason why the state constitution put that responsibility to the DA is that always expected that it would be the district attorney that would ensure that people play by the rules. Of course, that also entails that the district attorney has to play by the rules, right? Which in this case, we don't. So the district attorneys aren't going to have control over whether you create a police commission or not, or what, you know, what kind of civil service rules you play by in your city. Who do you hire as a chief of police? You're going to have a tremendous influence. You hire a cowboy, you're going to get a cowboy police department, right? Nothing wrong with cowboys. It's okay when you're in the farms and stuff. You know, it's bad when you're wearing a uniform. But the district attorney definitely plays a role when somebody violates the law. And that's the rule that unfortunately this county has to move out very well.
And what, as residents, as citizens, what can we do?
Well, I mean, first of all, you need to hold your police department accountable, mm-hmm. right? You gotta make sure that, you know, especially if you're in city council, you probably have a say-so who gets hired to be the chief, right? you don't get to say who was a patrol officer, but you know, you put a different police that is going to follow the rules according to your world. You know, police departments are a reflection of our city, by the way, the government. We can blame all the you can blame everybody, but if you put the chief of police in place, and you can take him. You may not be able to take the office yourself, but you can take chief of police out of there importantly. And I was just talking to a commissioner in Oakland, who I know, she worked for me, and the DA's office had a nightmare for the last few days, because we fired the chief of police, and it was so hard to do, but it was the right thing to do. Right? So you can do that, right? And then you can definitely demand different behavior for your police department. You also should demand the same things for the DA.
We're going to hold you accountable.
Please. Okay.
wait, there's some. Oh, there's questions.
I actually have a question, and you might have answered it, but when you touch the subject on innocent people being put in jail on the hands of bad policing or rogue police officers, my question to you is, what would your office do to change that culture, and at what point do we start holding police officers accountable? You said they should be held at a higher standard, but I believe that everybody should be held to the same standard regardless of the position. But however, unfortunately, police officers do pretty much have people's lives on their hands like doctors do. And a lot of times when you see on the news that someone was convicted incorrectly, or there was false information, or sometimes police influence witnesses in order to shut a case, what is your office going to do to make sure that there's consequences, or to maybe help us hold our law enforcement accountable for their actions, especially when it's done with ill intent?
Right. Well, first of all, you know, we have to make sure that internally the district attorney's office is clean. So that means that we don't use people as witnesses that should not be a witness. That means that we're very critical of the quality of the work that comes in to make sure that if we're proceeding with the case, we have sufficient evidence to go forward. That means that we have what we call truth in charging, meaning that we don't overcharge a case in order to get somebody to take a plea at a lower level and not be able to defend themselves because they're fearful of the consequences. That means that when a deputy DA in one of your office calls and says, I'm not going to file this case because I have a liar and I don't believe the story, and the chief of police calls you, you tell the chief of police, not only am I going to put that person in stand, but I am going to support this DA that is trying to do the right things, and I'm going to put that person in no-call list. That means also that we have a strong conviction review unit that is quality control internally to make sure that we're doing the right work, and that we also have a strong investigative arm when there is the allegations of police misconduct.
Would your office have any influence? So you mentioned how there's people that are sitting in jail and people know that they're sitting in jail. However, it takes years for them to get released. And the reason why I bring this up, a couple years ago, I watched a documentary called Mario's Story on Netflix. And it was a 16-year-old boy that was convicted of a murder that he did not commit, and the officers influenced the witnesses to help identify the individual. A mother lost her 16-year-old son that day who was innocent. The parents spent thousands of dollars in attorneys trying to get their son out. Everyone knew he was innocent, but yet he was sitting in jail. That's something, time you don't get back, time you have to cherish it. But my question is, would your office kind of help that situation as far as making sure that we're not putting people in jail that do not belong there? And if they are in there, would your office expedite for those people to be released? Because that's also a tax burden where you have a body in the jail system that does not belong there, and we're paying for that.
Yeah, I mean, the answer to that is both is yes. First of all, you know, you have to create some very good screening process in what cases you're going to move forward. But let's say that, you know, we're dealing with human beings, so sometimes there are going to be mistakes that are made maybe the officer was not intentionally, but they made a mistake, or maybe there were intentional officers in the story. Once you realize that was the case, you need to move very quickly to make sure the person gets released. And then you address what the officer's behavior was, depending on what they did. They made a mistake, you know, it's really an administrative problem with the police department. If they were criminally, in other words, they intentionally lied, then you have to evaluate whether you have enough evidence to prove it. If you do, you got to prosecute. And I did that before.
Well, I would like to say thank you to everyone because everybody,
yeah,
I have
touching up on what she said, and to your credit, in San Francisco, you had a great record of reducing the jail populations in San Francisco. So in Los Angeles accounts for about a third, I believe, of the state's prison population. So could you tell us a little about what you did to help end the mass incarceration in San Francisco and what you would do to implement that here in Los Angeles?
Well, look, I mean, the first thing that we did is we, you know, we brought in a bunch of researchers. So we were working with universities all the time, trying to understand what are the right level of intervention for different problems. So for instance, with juveniles, we created a restorative justice system, right, which we know works better, a lot of science behind it. That reduced a bunch of, you know, a bunch of kids from going to even juvenile hall. But then we never put kids in adult prison, which this county does regularly. We started to work more around mental health, not always successful because mental health is so complicated, but trying not to put the mentally ill in prisons and jail. We've worked with a lot of nonprofits in our county to look for ways to provide early intervention for a lot of low-level offenses. We created, for instance, the thing that we call neighborhood courts that we put in all the neighborhoods, and actually we're neighbors. We would train the neighbors at a nonprofit. And for a lot of low-level offenses, instead of going to court, we went to the neighborhood court, and we had the neighborhood adjudicators, with the supervision of a nonprofit, actually go through their fact-finding process and provide what they call directives, because they're not convictions, but you know, sometimes, like let's say you damage somebody's property or something, and it turned out to be that you did, the directive may be fix the property, or go work and get somebody to fix it, provide a public apology, maybe go to the local school and talk about the mistake you made and what the impact of that was. We found that the people that we sent to neighborhood courts, first of all, they were in court within 3 weeks, 4 weeks of the event, so it was very fast. They had to generally complete the directive within 6 months, so it was unlike the courts that take forever. But more importantly, it was the neighborhoods actually dictating what were the norms for that particular neighborhood in relation to that behavior. And it was very empowering for the neighbors. It provided a really good outcome for everybody involved. And the people that went in for this low-level offense would not rack up criminal convictions unless they went back again and they didn't follow the directives and then would bring them to court. So we were basically providing a better outcome for the victim, providing a better outcome for the neighborhood, and most of the time providing a better outcome for the person that had offended. We took those people out of the system, they never went to jail unless they came back again. So those are the things that we did regularly and that I would hope to do here.
So,
yeah, I'm hearing a lot of experience that you have, that you did a lot of great things in different places. I'm thinking you might be able to implement some of the stuff here too, as well. Maybe work with different nonprofit organizations. I do a lot of work in the community. I've helped a lot in the downtown with the homeless people, and I noticed that there's a homeless people there, but they're all different situations, you know. When it comes to that, like, what are you guys gonna like? Because I have an idea. I was thinking maybe talking to them and separating the ones that have mental health, separating the ones that have maybe just find financial hardships, and the ones that are really actually doing the crimes, because there's a little bit of everything there. Like, I've been there, we prayed with them, we talked to them, we sing with them and everything, and they need someone to talk to. But what do you guys, because there's a big problem in downtown. What would you maybe be implementing there?
Look, I think, you know, one of the things that I'm going to tell you is, just like I've told people in Lancaster, Pomona, and other places, we're going to find find different solutions for different communities because of the bandwidth, right? You may have a community that has some great nonprofits that we can go in and actually have volunteers that are going to be able to provide mental health services or housing. Other communities we may not have that, and we're going to have to figure out how to bring the bandwidth. The reality is that we want to reduce the footprint of the criminal justice system as much as we can and bring other partners into play, whether they're nonprofit organizations or churches or other groups, or you know, even county departments like mental health and social services, or the schools, to provide the interventions that sometimes are going to be much more effective than simply the hammer of sending you to jail for 3 days and you come back out again to the same corner, to the same things that you were doing the day before. To the point that you make, precisely separating the cases based on what their reality. You got the ones that are there because they cannot afford to have a home. Frankly, those are the easiest part of homelessness, because all you got to do is figure out a way to get housing for them. I know it, housing is not cheap, but actually if you have a family or individuals that can't afford housing, you generally can find help for them, right? The next layer is a more difficult layer. It's a layer that has substance abuse and mental health problems. Because even sometimes when you give a housing, they don't want the housing at that moment, right? And you have to figure out another way to intervene. And then, you know, the segment that is generally preying on the rest of the homeless, those, you know, you have to sort of break it down. Some are mentally ill themselves or drug addicted. Others are just right off predators, right? The solutions are really different. Being able to distinguish one from the other is really important. And that requires bringing the community, especially the people that have the foot soldiers on the ground, to be able to inform your decisions and make sure that we do the right approaches.
And one more thing for the question. There is $9.9 billion that they spend in homeless. So they do have the money. They problem is there. They don't know exactly what they do with the money. So I know this, and they try to fix that. And the other thing is that Mr. Gassetti tomorrow, they will have a big, in Los Feliz, they have a big event. They're doing some place, you know, for people that is homeless, so they're working in that. And it's not only in his hand, it's, you know, everybody.
Yeah. The governor put a lot of money in this year's budget for mental health services, housing, and then, you know, Prop 47 is putting $350 million a year into local governments, right? $70 million from Prop 47 have come to LA County. You gotta find out where that money is. $25 million left in the city of LA. People forget to tell you that Prop 47 actually puts a lot of money every year right back into local government for services that are not always being used for.
So thank you everyone, you know, for your time. Muchísimas gracias a todos por venir. Gracias por compartir su tiempo. Sé que es muy valioso. Sé que ya muchas personas se tienen que ir. Y les agradecemos muchísimo que hayan tomado el tiempo para venir a compartir esta noche. Les agradezco mucho si los apoyan a los dos, ¿verdad? Con sus votos, y y les agradezco que vengan y que los ayuden, ¿okay? So thank you everyone for being here tonight, and you know, it's my pleasure again, you know, to help also both of them. Mercy, Apet, Laugh, and Inchkipes.
And I also want to thank Maria from this restaurant for opening her doors for us. Maria?
Maria, muchísimas gracias.
Lord, thank you so much. Acuérdate que el pueblo.
Gracias por la comida tan rica, tan deliciosa.
Acuérdense que el pueblo es primero. Community first, okay? That's what our motto is for the Resident Club. All right, if anybody, you can stay just a little longer. I think some people want to take some pictures with you. Please come up and say hello. Okay?